This is Judge Joe Brown, and we're listening to We All Be News. News-free Dixie for the 21st century.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, scholars and laymen, welcome to another wonderful edutainment empowerment edition of The Art of It Stinks. Today's segment will be dealing with the unfortunate passing and the legacy of the purple one, known as Prince. That's right, boys and girls, scholars and laymen, will be dealing with the one and only Prince Rogers Nelson, who was born, who entered this world, who debuted June 7, 1958, and who exited April 21st, 2016. Very unexpectedly and very mysteriously. And we'll get into some of that stuff. And quite frankly, you know, I've been just been taken aback. My birthday was on April 23rd. So I remember who told me, I'll never forget where I was at and what I was doing when I heard the news that Prince left us for the other realm. Just like I won't ever forget where I was and what I was doing when I heard the glove one pass, Michael Jackson, or when 20 years ago, this September 13th, I will never forget where I was and what I was doing when I heard the news that Tupac passed, or when Notorious B.I.G., or when Princess Di. These things stay with you, or stay with me, or even Whitney Houston. These things stay with me, or those are the type of moments that stay with you to the day you die. And I just want to talk about Prince a little bit. Like, I've been looking at the internet, soaking up all these theories about the Illuminati. And a lot of times you get famous in this world by not how you live, but how you died, i.e. Emmett Till, Mike Brown, Freddie Gray. But Prince lived a very extraordinary life. He would be what Duke Ellington would call, Duke Ellington was born April 29th, 1899, by the way. He would be the type of person that Duke Ellington would call beyond category. A truly exceptional human being with a truly incredible talent. God quality talent. Prince is up there. So I'm going to read what Miles Davis had to say about the purple one. Miles Davis had high respect for Prince. Dr. World of Prince did collaborations with Prince before he passed. And this is his words of what he thought about Prince. He said that Miles Davis overstood Prince and, you know, in my opinion, gave the best summation of who he was in terms of his musicality, his music genius. This is the words of Miles Davis. Prince is from the school of James Brown, but Prince got some Marvin Gaye and Jimi Hendrix and Sly in him. Also, even Little Richard. He's a mixture of all those guys and Duke Ellington. He reminds me in a way of Charlie Chaplin. He and Michael Jackson. I think Prince's music is pointing toward the future. Miles Davis was so prophetic in what he said about Prince, and he was correct. Especially him and, you know, Michael Jackson. These guys changed the game forever. Prince, in my opinion, when you bring up Prince and compare him to like somebody like Little Richard, Prince, in my opinion, was Mr. Gender Fluidity. He was gender fluidity. He was androgynous. He took the Little Richard thing to the next level. Well, Prince was interesting because Prince had the admiration of both men and women. Men wanted to be like him, and women wanted to be with him. And some men wanted to be with him, you know, but he had an interest. I guess you could say he was almost like the first metrosexual, but he had a toughness about him and it came across in his music. He had a very much a mastery of his instruments, of his music. You know, he signed his first record deal at the age of 19, I believe, 3-album deal with Warner Brothers. He fought Warner Brothers for the right to control his music. So, meaning, like, you know, you think about Little Richard, who, you know, is a music genius in his own right, one of the architects of rock and roll. Now, he lost control of his music after he converted or became a born-again Christian. And it's kind of interesting you compare Prince and Little Richard. You know, these guys were blazing hot, you know. And, you know, they had these fights to get back control of their music, you know. And they had a come-to-Jesus moment. You know, Prince became famously known as a Jehovah's Witness. And, you know, he wasn't shy about sharing his faith with anybody who would listen. And sometimes he would appear on people's doorsteps. If you happen to live in Minnesota, you wouldn't be surprised to see Prince, I guess, on a weekend carrying a watchtower and talking to you about the benefits of being a Jehovah's Witness, which would probably be surreal for me. I had a couple of Jehovah's Witnesses knock on my door, and I was never thinking about joining them, but I did. I have been to a Kingdom Hall in my time or two, and I have conversed with them. I just like good dialogue. I like good conversation. Like, I'm known for traveling thousands of miles just to have a conversation with somebody. But anyway, let's get back to Prince. So Miles Davis had a great summation of who Prince was in terms of talent. And I want to point out a couple of things. Like, you know, people talking about the Illuminati. How did Prince die? Well, they said that he overdosed on Percocet. He had a painful hip injury that was due for him, I guess, dancing in high heels for a number of years, and being very athletic on his stage performances, giving it his all on the stage, took a toll on the body. Same thing they say with Michael Jackson, you know, dancing and just being a showstopper, a show stunner, take the toll on the body. I mean, because they got, you know, these guys were very athletic, they were very physical in their concert performances. This is like an athlete on the field. I mean, that type of punishment takes a toll on the body. You know, that stuff, you can't do that forever. You know, even Lady Gaga, as young as she is, got a hip replacement, I believe, or hip surgery. So they show you the type of work the show business is. And when people talk about Prince's death, how did he die? Why did he get cremated so suddenly? How, you know, he was cremated within like less than 24 hours, it seemed, of him being discovered in the elevator. And which is interesting, because when people get into this Illuminati stuff, and I always tell people, who was Lucifer in heaven? Who was Satan before he went to hell? He was heaven's master musician. Think about that. He was the master musician. So we always talk about people making a deal with the devil, especially musicians like Robert Johnson. You know, you look at the blues artists like Tommy Johnson. Somebody made a deal with the devil, whatever, and they, you know, Crossroads and all that stuff. But I like to point out, you know, in Prince's lyrics, Let's Go Crazy, it was kind of prophetic in a way, his lyrics, because, you know, in Let's Go Crazy, he talks about going down in an elevator. You know, it's very like interesting blues motif. I'm going down, you know, going down slow, or like, you know, I mean, just read the lyrics. I just think it's very important. And like, people, the internet is your friend to a certain degree. Use it, utilize it, you know, think for yourself. You know, so many people out here telling folks things and how to think and whatnot. But I think it's very important that people get hip to what's going on, because there's so much stuff going on. Even like right now, we are in a period called Mercury in retrograde. And you should look that up. And right now, that is happening from April 28th to May 22nd, I believe. That's when Mercury has the illusion of going backwards around its rotation around the sun, and things tend to happen, like, you know, miscommunication, tech problems, you know, technology problems. I had a couple of fax and email problems today, or yesterday rather, now on April 28th. So it's like, it's some truth to some of this stuff. Then you look at the year 2016, you add up 2 + 0 + 1 + 6, it equals 9. And 9 is the number of completion. So Dick Gregory, Baba Gregory, I have him on the show a lot, and I plan on having him on very soon to talk about this Prince thing, because Prince was turned on to chemtrails by Dick Gregory, actually wrote some songs, to talk about his awareness of what's going on, conspiracies and whatnot. There's a lot of stuff going on, people. I mean, this is not an ordinary year. The rhythm has changed. So, like, you know, Let's Go Crazy, one of Prince's popular songs, he said, are we going to let the elevator, Are we going to let the elevator bring us down? Oh, no, let's go crazy. You know, he repeats that throughout the song. It's about this elevator thing. And he's found lying unresponsive in the elevator before they pronounce him dead at his Paisley Park estate. You know, before the Grim Reaper come knocking on your door, tell me, are we gonna let the elevator bring us down? Oh no, let's go. Let's go crazy. You know, that stuff. So that's in Let's Go Crazy. And then people talking about the song, It Sometimes Snows in April, which was released on the Parade album, which was the official soundtrack for his movie Under the Cherry Moon. People talking about how there was a pink moon that appeared on April 22nd. And also when Prince died, this, you know, a couple of hours or moments after Prince was pronounced dead, there was a rainbow that appeared over Paisley Park. So, I mean, people talk about this crazy stuff going on, man. It's beyond category stuff. And I just want to mention all that. You know, like, cause people talk about when Tupac died, you know, you look at his lyrics and it said, people say he predicted his death. And I want to tell people that your words create worlds. Because you think about Tupac, you talk about death a lot, about dying young. And that what happened to him. He died at 25, 2 plus 5 to 7. Look at Notorious B.I.G. When I talk to young people, I would tell, I always ask them, what's the name of Notorious B.I.G., Biggie Smalls' first album? It was Ready to Die. What was the name of his second album? It was Life After Death. When did that second album come out? Or came out? It was after he died in L.A. on March 9th, 1997. And it's still officially unsolved murder case. So you think about this stuff, man. It was powerful stuff, man. Powerful. And so with Prince, was he murdered? Was it foul play? Well, I will say this. It was one of my mentors, an old head who passed away last year, who was the mentor of Isaac Hayes, the late great brother Emerson Abel, arguably the greatest high school music band director that the city of Memphis ever produced or seen. Arguably, you know, very high esteem he's held by his peers and former students, he told me. And he used to work at Stax for the Isaac Hayes movement. Isaac Hayes was one of his high school students. They kicked out the band, ended up working for Isaac Hayes to make history in music. But he used to tell me all the time, he said, Ron, nobody dies of natural causes in show business. Once again, he tell me, Ron, nobody dies of natural causes in show business. So Prince was a sacrifice of some type. Let me repeat, Prince was a sacrifice of some type. You got to think about it. Prince would wage an 18-year war to get control of his music from Warner Brothers, the same company he signed with when he was 19 to make the 3-album deal. So he got control of his music. It was an article in the New York Daily News that came out April the 19th, 2014, I believe. And it said that Prince secured rights to his music catalog for Warner Brothers. Let me see if I can find the exact title so y'all can look this up, because, you know, y'all been trained not to trust a black man when it comes to knowledge. And I'm used to that, getting the system white supremacy racism, that we can't trust black folk when it comes to information, although we trust certain other folk when it comes to misinformation all day long. It was the Daily News. It came out April 19th, 2014. Prince settles 18-year dispute with record company. So, you can look that up. It's online. New York Daily News. Okay? You find all that information. It said that, I'm reading a little bit. Prince now owns the rights to the music he recorded on Warner Brothers Records after years of disputes and battles with the record label. Warner Brothers announced Friday it had reached an agreement with the pop icon, who was signed to the label from 1978 to the mid-1990s, during which time he released key projects like Purple Rain, 1999, Diamonds and Pearls, and Around the World in a Day. Financial terms weren't disclosed. Prince's new partnership will include the release of previously unheard material from his nearly two-decade tenure on the label. A 30th anniversary edition of Purple Rain will be released this summer. Prince 55 said in a statement that he's pleased with the results of the negotiations and looks forward to a fruitful working relationship. The agreement comes years after the Prince's relationship with Warner Brothers soured as he failed to gain possession of the music he recorded for the label. He changed his name to an unpronounceable symbol and wrote the word slave on his cheek. He also vowed to re-record the 17 albums he released on the label and sell them on his own. After Warner, Prince began releasing music in 1996 over the internet, but didn't match his previous successes. He struck deals with Arista Records and Columbia Records, where he saw a comeback with the Grammy-winning Musicology in 2004. The singer has also released many albums through his own label, NPG Records, following his split with Warner. The Rock and Roll Hall of Famer also said he's working on new music from Warner Brothers. Prince has recently been performing with the all-female trio Third Eye Girl. So that's the New York Daily News, dated April 19th, 2014. And 2 years later, April 21st, 2016, Prince lays dead at his Paisley Park estate in Minnesota. So he only had 2 years to celebrate this important victory that he fought for a majority of his adult existence. You don't think that's a coincidence? Is that a coincidence? You know? And Prince is one of the most successful independent black artists in music history. People talk about Beyonce and Jay-Z, this Lemonade album she released about Becky with the good hair. What people don't understand is that Tidal, the streaming service that Jay-Z brought a couple years back, owned the exclusive rights to stream Prince music. That's right, boys and girls, scholars and laymen. No other streaming service, no Spotify, no iTunes, Apple, none of them own the rights to stream Prince's music but Tidal. So Jay and Bay, they made major bank last week. And y'all all confused and don't know what to do. You know, they keeping their eyes on their prize and bank account. So Prince talked about this. You can find articles online from as recently as last December that interviewed Prince talking about working with Tidal, the decisions why he made them the one to work with, and his thoughts about them being successful in the very near future. So this is crazy. So people don't understand that Prince is not an anomaly. He's not an outlier or outlier by any means if you look at the black history or the black narrative. And that's something we got to talk about, because that's not been talked about, amplified, really. You know, recently, Michael Jackson, of course, before he passed away, he had ownership of the Sony catalog. He controlled the catalog. And people talking about this reason why he was killed or murdered or assassinated was to get back control of that catalog. See, Prince and Michael Jackson was thinking about not only making money, but also generational wealth. Building wealth for their family to enjoy for generations. Just like white folks are allowed to do. Just like what Lucky Luciano, the crime boss, once said. He said, behind every great wealth, there's a great crime. Behind every great wealth, there's a great crime. America, the wealthiest country in the history of the planet, could not be created or sustained without some great crimes being involved. One of them really being the original sin of this country, which is slavery. Enslaved Africans, not interns, not unpaid interns, but enslaved Africans built this country and gave it its culture and identity. So never forget that. So if you look at, like, once again, Prince comes out of a continuum in the African community or African American community about controlling one's destiny, about controlling one's talent that helps generate wealth. Like, you know, like I said, Michael Jackson, when he was alive, the Beatles did not have one song on iTunes. As soon as Michael Jackson died, the Beatles got their catalog out there on Apple iTunes. All right. So that would, you know, white folks don't like when a black person outsmart them at their own game. And white supremacy doesn't like that. And so Michael outsmarted these folks at their own game. And really, it was Paul McCartney, of all people, one of the Beatles, that advised Michael to go this investment route and buying up Sun catalogs. And Michael Jackson ended up outbidding Paul McCartney and Yoko Ono, John Lennon's widow, for the rights to the Beatles catalog. So Paul McCartney had a falling out with Michael Jackson the last few years. You know, he was pissed off at Michael Jackson for following his advice. And people got to understand, you know, black people, man, people ain't helped, man, because you even go back to the Pullman Porter days where you have black men, you know, serving white folks, wealthy white men and white women on these trains going across the country. A lot of these Pullman Porters were not just servants. They went to school. They had masters and PhDs and were medical doctors. They were trained medical doctors, but they could not find work in the white man's world that was, you know, for the things they went to school. So they ended up becoming Pullman Porters, and to be a Pullman Porter in the black community was being like a superstar. You get to travel the country and got paid real well. But what these Pullman Porters used to do, they would listen to the white man talk about business. And because, you know, black folks, we were invisible for decades and generations in the country until the 50s or 60s when the Civil Rights Movement came along. All black folks looked alike. You know, black folks had no problems. Black folks smiled all the time. There was a lot of white people. They never really thought about this at all. But you had these black men who were privy to business dealings, backroom business dealings, while being servants, you know, and they were able to invest in stocks and stuff on Wall Street and buy real estate and become wealthy. So that's a story that needs to be amplified, because there was a lot of famous Pullman Porters. Malcolm X, of course, was a Pullman Porter. Also, you had Thurgood Marshall. I believe his father was a Pullman Porter. You had several known, but you also had black folks we don't know about today who were Pullman Porters and made a killing out the white man's advice. So you look about Sam Cooke. Sam Cooke got the idea to try to control his own publishing and songwriting and stuff like that, his masters. He tried to get the great Fats Domino to go into it, but Fats Domino wasn't having none of that. According to one source, you know, Fats Domino said something to the fact that the white man treats him well, treats him good, so why would he want to own his stuff? And basically, you know how we do it. Nigga, is you crazy? Nigga must be crazy, because I'm getting treated good, you know, because people forget that Fats Domino was outselling Elvis at one point in the 1950s. That Fats Domino was the biggest rock star in America at one point. This is back in the 50s. So, Sam Cooke started his label. You know, Sam Cooke was friends with Ray Charles. And Ray Charles, we all know, he owned his own masters. They were good friends. So, it was all about ownership. Then we see what happened to Sam Cooke. He was set up at a hotel. Under mysterious circumstances, he was killed. And so a lot of people say he was killed by the mob. In the industry, which might be true, his business manager was Alan Klein, who was a lawyer. Allegedly, Alan Klein was not a trustworthy associate for Sam. I think Sam was figuring out. I believe that Alan Klein had the SARS record label in his name, Sam Cooke's record label. And I think Sam thought he had it in his name, but after he died, after he was killed, Sam Cooke's widow, Barbara, sold his music catalog, whatever rights he had, to publishing, to Alan Klein, if I believe, like somewhere around $100,000 or $105,000. And that catalog generates millions of dollars. You know, Sam Cooke, one of the most popular artists of the 20th century. That catalog generates millions of dollars. But Sam Cooke was always thinking about building generational wealth. And they took him out in December of 64. I believe he was about 33 years old or 34. And you go 3 years later, in December of 67, they took out Otis Redding, another cat. And Otis Redding was an old soul, because he was just 26 when he died, but people thought he was close to 40. They didn't know that Otis Redding was just 26, and the last year of his life, he made $1 million back in 1967 off his music. So he made $1 million off his music the last year of his life, ended up dying in a plane crash. The only person that survived was Ben Colley of the original Barcades, and Ben Colley could not even swim. Now, there's a famous or infamous photo of Sam Cooke frozen to death, or he's in his chair, on his backside at the morgue in Wisconsin. Like, he's just sleeping. It's like, it's so eerie to see him, like, this king of soul, just in this repose, like he's in a peaceful slumber, fully dressed. Just 26 years old, but he was a very smart business person. He's buried on today a 300-acre ranch that he owned down in Georgia outside of Macon. So he had enough sense to buy 300 acres of land. He started his own publishing business, which controlled his publishing. He was a great songwriter. A lot of songs you think somebody else wrote, like, I can't get no satisfaction. Otis Redding song. It's not the Rolling Stones. It's Otis Redding. And the Respect song, y'all love to sing about. That's not Aretha Franklin. Otis Redding song that first, and he wrote it. That's his song. So he wrote several songs. So Otis Redding was smart enough to get his business enterprise together, but I talked to some old heads who knew Otis, and Otis was very progressive, like Sam. He was trying to urge his fellow black artists to not just take that flat fee, but to actually invest in owning their publishing. So he was like one of them rebel rousers telling people that you need to control your publishing. And he dies at 26 under mysterious circumstances. Like, we don't really know what happened, why the plane went down, but he died. And there's so many others, you know, we could talk about that try to control. I mean, you think about even when Jay Prince, Irv Gotti of Murder, Inc., Suge Knight, and I believe some other people try to control their distribution. And I mean, these hip-hop moguls, at the height of their powers, trying to come together, control the distribution of their music. Now, all of a sudden, you got the feds investigating everybody. You know, Suge go to jail for several years. Jay Prince getting harassed by the federal government. Irv Gotti, I went to jail, being set up by the federal government. You know what I'm saying? By the feds. I mean, they won't let you have a break, black people. And that's why black folks talking about when people like Prince died, oh, they were murdered because they controlled their music. But I'm saying, black folks, with all due respect to black people, I would rather die like that, you know, fighting for what's mine, than to die and be some type of hashtag for somebody's cause. You know what I'm saying? Like, we dying for less every day as black people. We're dying from poison drinking water. We're dying from police brutality. We're killing each other because we've been programmed. With the chemtrails and all this other stuff going on in the world, we're dying for less. To me, to fight for your family's survival and for their ability to thrive, to fight for your right to be a man, to fight for your right to exist and to have your talents really empower yourself and amplify your existence so you can help your people, that's something worth dying for. So we get it wrong, because all human activity, all areas of human activity is warfare in a system of white supremacy, racism. And Prince won the battle. He won a significant battle, but they would not give him the length of years to enjoy that victory. So yeah, Prince was a victim of white supremacy, racism. Just like all of us are. On every black person's death certificate should read death by white supremacy. Because until we break loose of this system, we will never really be truly liberated or free. Until we stop subsidizing and paying taxes for our own systemic genocide, we will never be free. Until we stop subsidizing and paying taxes for our own menticide, we will not truly be free as a people. Now, Prince fought for his. And that's a man, regardless if he's wearing eyeliner or high heels or purple sequins, he was a man because he fought for his. But unfortunately, what I'm hearing right now is that he had no will. So it's kind of strange that a person like that would fight that hard for the rights to control his intellectual property and would not leave a will. I think something else is involved in that. He might have a trust somewhere. I don't know. But all this stuff is kind of strange to me. But, you know, then again, Tupac talk about dying young. He didn't have a will. He knew he was going to die early. So why not leave a will? Why don't we leave stuff? We all got to die anyway. So why not leave a will to dictate our last wishes? See, that's what's going on right now. People concerned about what's going on, Prince. They say he's worth, his estate is worth what, $250-$300 million. Probably get more money just based on his image alone. I mean, he's an icon forever. He's a James Dean. He's an Elvis Presley. He's a Jimi Hendrix. He's a Bob Marley. He's a Marilyn Monroe. He's even a Tupac. Those icons never die. And there's a lot of money to be made off the image of Prince and his likeness. So they even got that weird, creepy Dye Dr. Pepper commercial that seems to be kind of reference to Prince. This is very subliminal, weird, creepy stuff going on with that Diet Dr. Pepper commercial. But yes, I am rambling. I am rambling with a cause. Like, you also look at, you know, people trying to figure out that he abused drugs and whatnot. And I'm thinking that, you know, they say he was addicted to Percocet, or he was a Percocet overdose. He was in pain from his hip injury sustained from his career of being a entertainer. They say he stayed up for about 156 plus hours before he died, which is interesting. And, you know, people show pictures of him going to Walgreens and riding bikes. Was that really Prince, though? I don't know. I ain't gonna get into all that. What do you mean, was it really Prince? I mean, when the bicycle picture just showed the back of somebody's head, I mean, it was Prince. Does it not mean it was Prince? Then getting in this SUV, that don't mean it was Prince either. A lot of folks that help doubles, we all help doppelgangers, for example. We all help, you know, people help doubles, people hire doubles, you know. But, you know, I'm not going to get into all that because people already got all that stuff out there. People already got all that, which is not, you know, Prince knew he was built to last in terms of his legend. He was so mysterious. He was such an enigma. So his legend is built to last like that. And people are going to be constantly questioning his death because, I mean, his body was cremated so fast. And you look at so many famous American murders or assassinations, the crime scene is always contaminated. Whether it be Dr. King's crime scene, Malcolm X's crime scene. Malcolm X actually had, a black church actually had a dance in the same spot where Malcolm X died in the Audubon that night. JFK, I mean, they cleaned up the limousine. There's a lot of stuff to be said. They did not do the autopsy. They violated Texas law and transported his body back. They allegedly transported his body back to the East Coast to do the autopsy. They really supposed to do the autopsy in Dallas. So there's a lot of things to be said about that. And also, Prince ain't the only star to die tragically connected to Big Pharma. It's like, you know, it's the legal drugs that's killing our stars and celebrities and people. It's not the illegal drugs. A lot of times we're killing people with the illegal drugs is what they use to cut the drugs with. It's the stuff they use to cut the drugs with, they're killing people a lot of times. But with the, you know, Big Pharma, it's the actual drug itself. Now, you know, I ain't the only person to stay up late at night, look at these commercials, the info commercials, all these little commercials, where they have this thing to cure one thing, but they cause you about 99 other problems. So is it worth taking this one thing to get rid of one element and you end up creating 99 more different elements? So I think about when Prince died, I was thinking about late great Dinah Washington, who was the most popular female singer of the 50s. I would say she was the most popular female singer of the 50s, black or white. She sung Unforgettable, What a Difference a Day Makes. She was the queen of the blues. She only died at 39 years old. Allegedly, she mixed alcohol with weight reduction pills and sleeping pills, something like that. So I don't think she knew what she was doing. I guess it was ruled accidental overdose. She was married to a seventh husband at the time, the great football player, Dick Night Train Lane. I believe his name, Night Train Lane, safety for the Detroit Lions at the time. She was 39 years old when she died. This is back in December 14, 1963. And what's up with these December deaths of these singers? You know, you got Sam Cooke, who died in December. You got Otis Redding, who died in December. And now you got Dinah Washington, who died in December. Dinah, 39. Otis was 26. And I believe Sam, if not mistaken, was 34. If not mistaken. So you got all this stuff going on, people. So is it a conspiracy? Yes, because all related. This whole thing, this whole system is conspiring against black folks from having success. Against black folks from controlling their destiny of self-determination, of group economics, group self-help, group identity. This whole system is run on group politics and group think. White supremacy always has been a team sport. And black folks, we don't know how to play team sports as we play in basketball or football or baseball or something like that. We play, see, we're ready for the playoffs, but we never ready for the revolution. We're ready for the playoffs, but we never ready for the revolution.
And people like to talk about blood sacrifices. What do you think about this? That Prince died April 21st on the same day of Queen Elizabeth II's birthday, who was born April 21st, 1926. So what was Prince a blood sacrifice for the royal family or for Queen Elizabeth II? I mean, you know, you can think about this. And getting back to the Parade album, which featured Under the Cherry Moon, I mean, or the Parade album, which was the official soundtrack for Under the Cherry Moon. It came out, I believe, March of 86. And Under the Cherry Moon is the 30th anniversary of that film. And now people are reappraising the value of Under the Cherry Moon. And now I guess it's like a cult classic, as they say. But the critics are coming around to seeing it Prince way some 30 years later. So isn't it odd that 30 years later that Prince is dead? And the song Sometimes It Snows in April was on that soundtrack from 30 years ago for Under the Cherry Moon. And then there was a pink moon around the time that Prince transitioned. So, I mean, you could think about all these coincidences or whatever you want to call it. But, you know, I'm not what my friend late John Judge would say. I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I'm a conspiracy realist. All this stuff is conspiring. Everything is like Einstein, the theory of relativity. Everything is related. Everything's related. Everything's connected. And what people heard me say, connect the dots, la la la. So you think about all that. And I like to say that, you know, there's a lie in every truth and there's a truth in every lie. So people tell me, well, all this information overload. And that's a good thing, actually, to have all this information available at your fingertips. But the thing about it is, what do you do with the information? Do you just do intellectual masturbation? Do you sit on the information and play keep away from other people? What good is information if you can't share it? So I'm glad that people are thinking for themselves. And sometimes you got to go to the extreme to get to the real root of the issue. Sometimes you got to go way out there to get back to the middle of someplace. Because a lot of us, I mean, this 2016 is the year of the extreme. If you ain't going extreme, you might well go home, because you ain't going hard enough. You're not going to get anywhere. You're not going to get the results you think you'll get. You got to do things in the extreme this year in order to get the results that you seek. You know, you got to go really extreme in 2016. And this year is a roller coaster ride. The rhythm has really changed. And it's going to be interesting to see how it all plays out towards the end. And you got to think about also Vanity, one of Prince's muses and proteges. She passed away at 57 back in February of this year. And people said that she said that was the only man she truly loved. And Prince, he had a way of bringing out these things in women like Sheila E., Vanity, even Carmen Electra. He had, you know, women just love Prince. They had this thing about Prince that he was truly a ladies' man and a master musician. He played all the instruments on his first albums and whatnot. Amazing creative spirit, amazing creative mind. Distinctive sound, distinctive man. Like Duke Ellington said, truly beyond category. He would definitely be missed, but he won't be missed because he's all around us. Prince lives forever. He's forever young. So that's a good thing. But there's some food to thought to throw out there, ladies and gentlemen, scholars and laymen, about Prince. Like he said, he comes from that continuum of artists wanting to own their own self outright. Had to make that Faustian deal with the music industry, and just understand that history, and don't be afraid. We also lost Maurice White this year of Earth, Wind, and Fire. We lost so many people. Natalie Cole, Otis Clay. So many unsung heroes and sheroes that we have lost. But and the beat goes on. Time keep on slipping. So Prince, yeah, I'm a big Prince fan. And like, you know, the soundtrack of my life, you know, some great songs he did. I love Prince music. He was a music genius. Thank God that he left so much music with us. And also thank God that he left so much unreleased music that I look forward to hearing for years to come. I just hope that the people who are in charge of his music legacy will honor the man's creative genius in the right and appropriate way. They will do right by him by doing right by the music. So I look forward to hearing, like so many other fans, his unreleased music. But I just hope and I pray that his family finds some peace of mind and that they do get compensated for the loss of this loved one who shares so much with the world. And on people, they criticize his sister. I think his sister did the best thing she could. Try to get help with the estate, because you damn if you do, damn if you don't. People are all on the sidelines criticizing her, talking about her past. We all got a past. Like, you know, like they say, every saint got a past and every sinner got a future. So, I mean, if you don't have a past, I mean, you haven't really been doing any living. And so you really are somebody I really care to hang around, because you're not interesting, because everybody should have a story, you know. So I definitely have a story, but what else is there to say? But I think I put out enough information about Prince, my thoughts. I might do another show, and definitely been reaching out to Dick Gregory Camp to get a response for all you Dick Gregory fans. You already know what he probably thinks about this thing. I don't know why y'all like, we got to hear from Dick Gregory. You know, you already know what he's thinking about this. He going to lay it out in his way, but, you know, he already know. There's a game, you know, and the thing about it is, like Baba Dick been saying so recently, recess is about over. Playtime is about over, y'all. We need to get right, because this year may be the last year. It may not be the last year for everybody, but it'll be the last year for some of us. We all ain't gonna make it to 2017. Well, it could quite possibly mean none of us make it to 2017. So enjoy yourself, enjoy your loved ones. Make the most of your days, and just be the best person you can be. Be your best version of yourself, and the rest will take care of itself, and the best is yet to come. That's my take on Prince for right now. And if you like what you heard, please feel free to donate, tell a friend, join the We All Be movement. Well, we are in our 10-year anniversary period. We started back in April 2006, and we're still here April 2016. Started as a blog. Now we're here, doing what I'm doing, podcasts and whatever you want to call it. But I know that the best is yet to come. I look for 10 more years and 10 more years after that. And so thank you all for taking the time to listen. Keep producing and pushing. And in the words of the great Duke Ellington, we love you all madly.